too many redundant processes in an organization can stunt the growth in any company, really. Joining us now to talk more about this very topic, growth strategist, keynote speaker, a Wall Street Journal bestselling author, and What's Next podcast host, Tiffani Bova. Welcome.
Thank you for having me, Shrine. Nice to see you.
Yeah, so, you know, it's great. We have you on all the time, and you bring so much, and your insight is very valuable. I'd love to have you in person, so thanks for joining us. Talk to us about your recent post when you talk about redundant processes, how they hinder a company.
Well, it was an interesting journey. It's not like I woke up one day and went, I'm going to really learn everything I can about processes. It was through research of trying to understand what pieces and parts of the employee experience have positive and negative impacts on a company's ability to serve their customers. And one of the biggest areas of pain for employees was processes. Broken processes, out of date processes, or no process at all, right? And then it's the manual process, if you will. And technology has complicated those processes, unfortunately. And so that's what led me down this path of trying to understand, hold on a second, you know, is it really taking too much time for employees to do something so they can't actually do what they were hired to do or actually find joy in what they're doing,
you know? Yes.
And so I think that processes are one of those areas that leaders, managers, small business owners sometimes are moving so quickly that they forget that they might have done something a year ago that's no longer valid or appropriate today.
And that's where the redundant comes in. Are there a certain, you know, order that you should put your processes in to be successful?
It's a great question. Here's what I'd say. Sometimes people don't even know what processes are in place currently. So you could do a couple things. You could ask your employee base, tell me the one or two top processes or tasks you have to do that are either repetitive, you know, redundant, right? Broken or manual. And if I could fix those for you, it would free up more time for you to do what we've hired you to do. If you could just ask that simple question and don't overcomplicate things, like ask in an email and say, answer me in an email, right? If you've got 10 or 15 employees, you could actually ask that question and have an email box set up to respond. Then once you can collect all those responses, start working down those processes that have actually are holding your people back. Start there.
Okay.
And then maybe you create a feedback loop where if you find a broken process, send it into this email box, right? And then we will start to capture them. And if they're easy fixes, what a great way to send a message to your people that not only do you care about what they do every day, but if you ask and they answer and you action it, it builds a tremendous amount of trust between you and your employees.
I can see that. You know, when you have a smaller company or even bigger company, really, what can you do? What types of things can you do to make sure you have a long-term survival? Because I feel like that's kind of the end game for a lot of people and owners as well.
What's interesting is through other research, not mine, it showed that one of the biggest hindrances to long-term repetitive and scalable growth is internal bureaucracy versus external forces. Okay. Now, I realize we've just come out of a once-in-a-lifetime black swan event in a pandemic.
Sure.
If you put that aside and you say, "What is it really external forces that are keeping me back from getting sustainable growth? Or is it internal bureaucracy, right? Some of it is this redundant process. Some may be products are too slow to get out the door. It may be that you don't have people on staff to answer the phone 24/7. So should you be, you know, outsourcing that? Whatever the reason may be, is it internal that's holding you back where many people will immediately blame something on the outside, right? Is it scared of being the recession? Is it interest rates? Is it, you know, tightening of the belt? Is it economic woes? All true. But are there things you could be doing internally that set you up for success regardless of what's happening outside of your market?
You know, we keep bringing up the pandemic, right? Because it's a really real thing. It's in the past, but not really. What do you feel we've learned from this is from a business standpoint going forward? We hope to never have to face something like that again, but in preparation and perhaps.
Yeah, what worries me and what I tend to focus on is I feel like we made a lot of really good strides during the pandemic, especially around employees, making sure they were okay, they were safe, mental health and well-being.
Sure.
You know, all that all of a sudden came into hyper focus. and everyone went home overnight. And so then it meant, do our people have what they need to be successful working remotely? Mm-hmm. I worry that now that everyone's trying to get their employees back to the office, you know, that's still a battle. Okay, sure. Is it 2 days? Is it a mandate? Is it Monday, Wednesday, Friday? Like, you don't just say one day, okay, everybody back to the office, and everyone's like, okay, let's go. Mm-hmm. That we know that's not what's happening. Mm-hmm. Is that I don't want us to snap back to the way it was pre-pandemic. I want to make sure that the lessons we learned during that time, we apply now. And we don't remove the things like mental health and well-being and more balance and, you know, the things that people really enjoyed and appreciated during that time. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to pull back on things, make sure you're not, you know, pulling a thread that has implications that people start leaving your organization or they start quiet quitting, right? Where then they're just accepting a paycheck, or they might be working for someone else at the same time they're working for you, double dipping, right?
Yeah.
So I'd say take the lessons learned, apply the good things we learned there. Mm-hmm. And if there are things that you learned that uncovered maybe some of the things that were challenging or didn't work for your people and your customers and your organization during that time, don't go back to those bad habits. So mm-hmm. I'd say from those challenges, hopefully the lessons learned will continue to keep moving businesses forward. But it's never going to go back to the way that it was. And I don't think it will stay the way it was. It's going to fall somewhere in between there. And I think every organization is different on where that'll fall.
And I think you still, you know, face that struggle, right? Because if you're a business owner, maybe you're a little bit more seasoned, let's call it that, right? Or baby boomers, we've talked about before in the past. And then you have the younger generations. There's still definitely a gap. How do you bridge that gap then to meet in the middle somewhat?
Yeah, and that's a great point, because this is the first time in the history of businesses or employment that six generations have been working simultaneously, yeah. right? Yeah. And so that's complicated, especially if you have leaders and managers that are maybe are of different generations and different times, and they had different habits and different ways of working. That impedes and impacts, you know, the employees around them.
Sure.
So I think this goes back to what we were just saying, right? You want to make sure that you're asking your employees what works for them. Mm-hmm. How do they like to be managed? What inspires them to work? Mm-hmm. Because not everyone is the same regardless of generation. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're just not all the same.
Yeah.
So if you're a leader and you're listening to this and you have an opportunity to understand your individuals and how they want to be led, you can't do everything everyone wants to
sure.
do, but you can't just say, I don't care what they think, I'm just going to do it the way I want to do it. That's not a good strategy for success.
In addition to that, what are some other things that business owners and entrepreneurs can do to kind of make a more, I don't know, harmonious work environment and just, you know, overall improvement as a company? I feel like happy employees, then you have more productivity, more growth, and everything seems to flow better.
I'd say that most of the time, and through the research we found, that most of the time when people say what you just said, they tend to focus on the human resource side of the employee, mm-hmm. right? Do they have the right benefits, right compensation, right? Do we
sure.
have a strong stand on DE&I, whatever it might be, right? But on the other side of that, right, the organizational structure, the technology tools they use, the processes, which we began this conversation with, mm-hmm. what are those? And what's the culture of the organization? That people, process, tech, and culture, those four areas require all the time attention.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to think about them uniquely and separated the way I just did. And so if you've done a really good job on people and culture, have you ignored process and technology? Mm-hmm. If you've really focused on technology, but you haven't focused on people and culture, then it doesn't work. You have to really focus on all four. And as a small business owner, you're like, look, I'm running everything. I don't have yeah. time to do all these things. But that's where you have to be really disciplined and carve time daily to say, I'm going to go talk to somebody about the technology they use every day. Or the next day, I'm going to go talk to somebody about the processes they have mm-hmm. to. You have to manage by wandering around and having those one-on-ones, whether it's virtual or it's face-to-face. As a leader, that is your truth. It's not you sitting in your four walls and think you know what's yeah. going on and getting it from a report or spreadsheet. It is really from those conversations with your people.
And I think that is so true, because I feel like from the outside, if you haven't started a business and you are looking to do so, that is often the thought, right? But you are managing so many different departments, and for them to work seamlessly, it's putting that effort in the front end, so you can get a good outcome in the end. Any final thoughts for us, Tiffani? This has been great.
Yeah, the last thing I'd say is, you know, this is an opportunity at the beginning of the year to make sure that you're setting the priorities for the company in a really clear and articulate way so that your people understand what they should be focused on. I went to a state school. But last I checked, there's one first priority, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And so you can't say, here's the five things or eight things or 10 things we're going to focus on this year, because then people are like, well, what's my priority? Where am I spending my time?
Sure.
Who should I be hiring? With what skills? Where should I be spending money? So really setting those priorities and communicating that in a transparent way with your people and allowing them to give you feedback. But you have to set those priorities so people know where to focus their time.
What state school?
Arizona State. Sun Devils.
Great school, yeah.
Sun Devils.
Good, awesome. Well, thank you so much for your time today. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you for having me.
All right.